After studying this module, you shall be able to learn about the invention of RFLP, understand the principle of RFLP, understand the functions of restriction endonucleases, VNTR, STR and RFLP, understand the method for detection of RFLPs, comprehend clinical applications for detecting VNTRs, STRs and RFLPs, and interpret the results. Restriction fragment length polymorphism, RFLP, is a widely used technique in the field of molecular biology to differentiate the organisms by analyzing the cleavage patterns of their DNA using restriction enzymes. The technique has found widespread applications in the field of forensic sciences to provide evidences against the criminals. RFLP, commonly pronounced RIF-LIP, exploits the variations in the homologous DNA sequences. It refers to differences between the samples of homologous DNA molecules that are derived from differences in their restriction sites, which are then visualized and analyzed by a related laboratory technique such as Southern blotting. If the DNA sample is derived from two different organisms, then the length of the DNA fragments produced after restriction digestion will vary. This is because of the difference between the distances within the sites of DNA cleavage by a particular restriction endonuclease. The similarity and differences within the generated patterns can be used to differentiate species and even strains from one another. Primary basis of the RFLP is the polymorphism in DNA sequences that are inherited differences observed among the individuals of a population seen in more than 1% of normal population. In RIF-LIP analysis, the DNA sample to be analyzed is first digested by restriction enzymes and the resultant smaller fragments called the restriction fragments are separated according to their molecular weight by agarose gel electrophoresis. If two organisms differ in the length of the restriction fragments, that is molecular weight, or the distance between sites of cleavage of a particular restriction endonuclease, then the length of the fragments produced will differ when the DNA is digested with a restriction enzyme. The similarity of the derived patterns can then be used to identify as well as differentiate the species or even individual strains from one another. Over the last decade, RIF-LIP has become largely obsolete because of advancements made in the DNA sequencing technologies and cost minimization. Nonetheless, the RIF-LIP analysis was the first DNA profiling technique inexpensive enough to see widespread application. Along with genetic fingerprinting, RFLP has been an important tool in genome mapping, determination of gene locus associated with genetic disorders, calculation of risk for disease, and paternity testing. The basic technique for detecting RFLPs involves fragmentation of a DNA sample by using a restriction enzyme. The restriction enzyme digests the DNA sample at specific restriction sites, and thus restriction digestion of DNA sample results in fragments of variable length of nucleotides. The resulting DNA fragments are then separated according to their molecular weight, which is directly dependent upon length, by agarose gel electrophoresis. following electrophoresis, the resolved fragments of DNA are then transferred to nylon or nitrocellulose membrane by sudden blotting. Membranes are then hybridized with a labeled DNA probe, which then binds to its complementary sequences transferred on the membrane at positions corresponding to the agarose gel. A riff lip occurs when the length of a detected fragment varies between individuals. Each fragment length is considered an allele and can be used in genetic analysis. Discovery of RFLP. DNA analysis was surfaced in the 1980s by Dr. Alec Jeffries and his team at Leicester University. In the year 1985, when the first DNA fingerprint was found, it was thought of as a miracle in the field of science. Dr. Alec Jeffries and his team were credited with the discovery of a process that detects specific genetic regions. In the late 1970s, when the molecular biology and molecular human genetics were still in their infancy, Dick Flavel and Alec Jeffries got to the point where they were able to identify lone copies of human genes, and that further led to the first observation of introns, that are the non-coding regions of DNA in split genes. Following his work in Leicester in 1977, Jeffries planned to use the primitive gene detection methods to understand and analyze the structure of genes and inherited variation within the individuals. The outcome of this research was the discovery of the first SNP in 1978 and ultimately restriction fragment length polymorphism. DNA digesting enzymes target short DNA sequences and cleave the genome into small fragments. Variation in the sequences by substitution of bases in DNA, a single nucleotide polymorphism or SNP, results in alteration of the target site, preventing the enzymes from cutting the DNA at that site. At the level of DNA, RIFLIP was an evidence of the inherited variation. However, they were difficult to examine and find and did not inform about variation between individuals. This prompted Jeffries to start looking for pieces of DNA that would be more variable than SNPs. The main part of the RFLP is the tandem DNA repeats, wherein the short sequences of DNA was repeated many times in a row and is open to mutation processes such as duplication and recombination. These tandem repeats were found to be highly variable and informative genetic markers. In his own words, Professor Alec Jeffries says, "The true story of DNA fingerprinting starts at the headquarters of the British Antarctic Survey in Cambridge. I collected a big lump of seal meat from their lockup freezer and had a look at the human myoglobin gene, and there, inside an intron in that gene, was tandem repeat DNA, a mini satellite. This mini satellite was to prove the key to the rest of the genome, for while it was not variable itself, its sequence was similar to the very few mini satellites that had been described previously. Using the myoglobin mini satellite as a hook, the team could then identify more mini satellites and, to their surprise, discovered a core sequence, that is, a piece of DNA that is similar in many different mini satellites. Using the core sequence, we made a probe that should latch onto lots of these mini satellites at the same time, says Professor Jefferies, and to test out the system, we hybridized the probe to a blot with DNA from several different people. On a Monday morning in September 1984, the X-ray of the blot was developed in the Leicester University darkroom. I took one look and thought, what a complicated mess, and then suddenly realized we had patterns, says Professor Jefferies. There was a level of individual specificity that was light years beyond anything that had been seen before. It was a eureka moment. Standing in front of this picture in the darkroom, my life took a complete turn. We could immediately see the potential for forensic investigations and paternity, and my wife pointed out that very evening that it could be used to resolve immigration disputes by clarifying family relationships. The potential of DNA fingerprinting was clear, but could the technology be improved? 2 to 3 months later, the grubby mess of the first fingerprint had been refined into clean patterns where DNA fingerprints, unique to an individual, could be deciphered clearly. DNA fingerprinting was ready for prime time. Principle of RFLP. RFLP is based upon the principle of detecting only a few polymorphisms that are available in sequences related to the probe. These polymorphisms are present in the DNA sequences due to base alterations, including substitutions, duplications, insertions, deletions, or rearrangements in DNA segments. The RFLPs are visualized using molecular probes for hybridization so that sequence polymorphisms are detected in only those genomic regions which are homologous to the probe used. This also eliminates complexity of analysis because the fragments produced are far too many to be visualized independent of each other, and upon electrophoresis, they produce a smear on the agarose gel. The use of selected probes allows screening within a very small fraction of DNA fragments for studying polymorphism. Restriction endonucleases. Restriction endonucleases are a group of enzymes that cleave DNA molecules at specific nucleotide sequences that are called restriction sites and depend on the particular enzyme used. Enzyme usually identifies sites of about 4 to 6 base pairs in length called the recognition sequence or restriction sites. In general, the shorter the recognition sequence, greater will be the number of resultant restriction fragments. If molecules differ in nucleotide sequence, fragments of different sizes may be generated. The fragments can be separated by gel electrophoresis. In the past, hundreds of restriction enzymes have been isolated from a wide variety of bacteria and are thought to be part of the cell's defenses against invading bacteriophages. These enzymes are named by using the first letter of the genus, the first two letters of the species, and the Roman numeral for the order of discovery. For example, Eco R1, SMA 1, etc. Genetic variations. Genetic variations can be of different types, SNPs or single nucleotide polymorphisms, MNPs or multinucleotide polymorphisms, and microindels come under the category of small scale genetic variations. In case of multinucleotide polymorphism, there is variation of nucleotide in a single common length, for example, the DNPs or double nucleotide polymorphism, and TNPs or triple nucleotide polymorphisms with 2 and 3 variable nucleotides respectively. Microindels are deletions, duplications, and combinations thereof involving the gain or loss of 1 to 50 nucleotides. According to an estimate, the human genome contains over 3 million SNPs located with an average distance of approximately 1000 BP or base pairs. On the other hand, the frequency of DNPs and TNPs, the most common form of MNPs, has been approximated to be around 1% of the total number of SNPs. Most likely, the genome-wide occurrence of small insertions and deletions has been underestimated, probably reflecting an inaccuracy of the current sequencing techniques. While one study identified 4 lakh indels of 1 to 16 base pairs in length from a personal genome, another report mentions approximately 1,50,000 indels with a size of 1 to 3 base pairs. SNPs, microindels, and other types of small scale genetic variations are implicated in monogenic as well as complex diseases. They may also be involved in individual drug responses because SNPs and microindels in genes encoding drug metabolizing enzymes such as CYP2D6 may lead to the loss of enzyme activity and slow metabolism of a variety of important drugs. As a result, large efforts have been directed to develop techniques for genotyping of small-scale variations, in particular SNPs. This approach has resulted in the emergence of an abundance of techniques for this purpose, well known of which is the PCR RIFLIP. RIFLIP analysis may be subdivided into single or SLP and multiple locus probe or MLP paradigms. SLP method is usually preferred over MLP because of its higher sensitivity, easier interpretation, and capability of analyzing mixed DNA samples. Moreover, data can be generated even when the DNA is degraded, for example, when it is found in bone remains. Detection of RFLPs. Detection of RFLPs can be made using the following steps. Number one, a suitable sample from the individuals or organism is collected, such as blood, tissues, buccal swab, etc. Number two, DNA is isolated and purified from the samples. Number three, purified DNA from the samples is restriction digested with a suitable restriction enzyme. Each sample is digested separately with the same restriction enzyme. Number four, restriction digest of the DNA samples is resolved by agarose gel electrophoresis in separate lanes. Fragments resolve according to their molecular weight, that is length, from higher to lower in the direction away from the wells. Number five, the separated DNA fragments are then transferred from gel to a nitrocellulose membrane using southern blotting. Number six, southern blots on the membrane are hybridized with a radioactively labeled molecular probe, or non-radioactively labeled probes are often used as probes. Number seven, the hybridized blots are used for exposing an X-ray film, which is developed to a corresponding autoradiogram. Number eight, the fragments which are partially or fully homologous to the probe can be visualized on the autoradiogram. Advantages of RFLPs. Highly robust methodology and results can be reproduced within different laboratories. Codominantly inherited genetic variations can provide information about homozygosity or heterozygosity of the organism. Sequence information is not required. Since the technique is based upon the sequence-specific probes, it can be used for phylogenetic analysis between related species. Suitable for construction of genetic linkage maps. Locus-specific markers that allow synteny studies. The technology can be used at both level of species and population using single locus probes, as well as individuals, that is using multi-locus probes. The technique is relatively simple and can be applied readily following the availability of desired probes. Disadvantages of RFLP. Large amounts of DNA are required, low throughput, automation not possible because of presence of multiple steps. It is not very effective in species with lower degree of polymorphism. Few loci detected per assay. Requires a suitable probe library. Time consuming, especially with single copy probes. Higher cost of analysis per sample. Distribution of probes to collaborating laboratories is required. Development and analysis of RFLP requires technical skill. Different probes or enzyme combinations may be required for different samples. Applications of RFLP. RFLPs can be used in many different settings to accomplish different objectives. Number one, paternity cases or criminal cases to determine the source of DNA sample, that is, it has forensic applications. Number two, determination of the disease status or genetic predisposition towards a disease of an individual. Number 3, measurement of recombination rates, which can lead to a genetic map with the distance between RFLP loci measured in centimorgans. Number 4, genetic diversity within different phylogenetic groups. Number 5, genetic relationships in case of disputed parentage. Number 6, origin and evolution of species. Number 7, genetic drift and selection. Number 8, whole genome and comparative genome mapping. Number 9, gene tagging. Number 10, unlocking valuable genes from wild species. Number 11, construction of exotic gene libraries. Summary. RFLP is a widely used technique in molecular biology and forensic science to differentiate organisms by analyzing the cleavage patterns of their DNA by using restriction enzymes. RFLP was discovered by Professor Alec Jeffries in 1984 while working in Leicester University. Principle of RFLP is based upon detection of polymorphisms that are available in sequences related to the probe. These polymorphisms are present in the DNA sequences due to base alterations, including substitutions, duplications, insertions, deletions, or rearrangements in DNA segments. The visualization of RFLPs is based upon the use of molecular probes for hybridization so that sequence polymorphisms are detected in homologous regions within the genome. One of the major prerequisites for the RFLPs is presence of restriction site for the restriction endonucleases, which are a group of enzymes that cleave DNA molecules at specific nucleotide sequences that are called restriction sites. Enzymes usually identify sites of about 4 to 6 base pairs in length called recognition sequences or restriction sites. RFLP can be detected by a series of manual steps that include sample collection, DNA isolation, restriction digestion, electrophoresis, southern blotting, autoradiography, and analysis. The technique has found wide array of application in forensic science, molecular biology, and other allied branches where it is used to compare multiple samples simultaneously to assess the relationship.